Good morning, everybody. It's great to see you this morning. So good to see a shirt full of the I Love Odessa crowd. Great to see everybody here. What a great weekend it has been, has it not? It's been awesome. I'd like to say welcome to everybody who's not normally in attendance with us, whether it's from the Church of Christ or from the community. I've got to meet several of you guys, so thank you so much for joining us today. It's wonderful to see you here. Just a few announcements to go over very quickly, so if you have your bulletin, you can go ahead and open it up and follow along. First of all, I wanted to make sure that everybody knows that right after this service, we are going to have breakfast over here in the Refuge, okay? Everybody's invited, so come on over. We're going to have breakfast. They've been cooking since about 7 o'clock this morning. They've got the pancakes grill fired up, so we're ready to go. So come on over, join us for breakfast. We'd love to see you there. And then after breakfast, we are going to head over to the Church of Christ for anybody that wants to join them at their service as well. So I'd encourage everybody to go ahead and do that so we can really show just unity in this weekend. So Jason, raise your hand. There's Pastor Jason back there. So we'll head over to his church afterwards. All right. Yes. And lunch. I've told there's lots of food, so you guys don't even have to cook today. You know, there you go. So breakfast over here, lunch at their church. So we're looking forward to that. All right. We have a lot going on. Easter's just around the corner. I wanted to make sure that you are aware of the Easter Lily donation, a dedication. So if you want to look in your bulletin, it talks about that. And there should be information in the back of your seat as well. Also, we are going to have a baby dedication coming up soon. So if you have a child or a grandchild that you would like to participate in this baby dedication, make sure to look in the bulletin. There's a tear strip and that you can let us know and we will plan accordingly for that. Okay? All right. It is so good to see you here this morning. If this is your first time attending, what we'd like you to do is go ahead and turn to the back of the bulletin where it says welcome. If you could please just fill that out and just drop it in the offering plate when it passes by in just a little bit. That way we can get some information about you and some information to you about our church. We'd really appreciate that. And one last thing, if you have, you're joining us today and we got to help you out with an I Love Odessa project and this is your first time visiting, there are gift bags. We just want to say thank you for visiting with us this morning. And so make sure to stop by at the information desk and we are going to give you guys a gift bag. So I just want to make sure that you stop by and you know about all those things. All right. It is a great morning to be together. It is good to see you all this morning. Let's take a moment, stand, find somebody that you haven't greeted yet this morning, and welcome them to First Baptist Church.
To see everybody here this morning, let's sing together. There's a sweet, sweet spirit in this place, and I know that it's the presence of the Lord. There are sweet expressions on each face, and I know that it's the presence of the Lord. Sweet Holy Spirit, sweet heavenly dove, stay right here with us, filling us with your love. And for these blessings, we lift our hearts in praise. Without a doubt, we'll know that we have been revived. when we shall leave this place. Amen. Amen. Marcy. Sing the wondrous love of Jesus. Sing his mercy and his grace in the mansions bright and blessed. He'll prepare for us a place when we all get to heaven. What a day of rejoicing that will be when we all see Jesus. We'll sing and shout the victory. Let us then be true and faithful, trusting, serving every day. Just one glimpse of him in glory will the toils of life repay. When we all get to heaven, what a day of rejoicing that will be. When we all see Jesus, we'll sing and shout the victory. Onward to the prize before us, soon his beauty we'll behold. Soon the pearly gates will open, we shall tread the streets of gold. When we all get to heaven, what a day of rejoicing that will be. When we all see Jesus,
we'll sing and shout the victory.
Amen. Amen.
We were the beggars.
Now we're royalty. We were the prisoners. Now we're running free. We are forgiven, accepted, redeemed by His grace. Let the house of the Lord sing praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord. There's joy in the house of the Lord today. And we won't be quiet. We shout out your praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord. Our God is surely in this place. And we won't be quiet. We shout out your praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord. There's joy in the house of the Lord today. And we won't be quiet. We shout out your praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord. Our God is surely in this place, and we won't be quiet. We shout out your praise. 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 The depths of the sea, creation's revealing your majesty. From the colors of fall to the fragrance of spring, every creature unique in the song that it sings, all exclaiming, indescribable, uncontainable, you place the stars in the sky and you know them by name. You are amazing, God. All-powerful, untamable, awestruck, we fall to our knees as we humbly proclaim. You are amazing, God. Told every lightning bolt where he should go, or seen heavenly storehouses laden with snow, who imagined the sun and gives source to its light, yet conceals it to bring us the coolness of night. None can indescribable, uncontainable, you place the stars in the sky and you know them by name. You are amazing, God. All powerful, untamable, awestruck we fall to our knees as we humbly proclaim. You are amazing, God. You are amazing, God. Indescribable, uncontainable, you place the stars in the sky and you know them by name. You are amazing, God. All-powerful, untamable, awestruck we fall to our knees as we humbly proclaim, you are amazing, God. Indescribable, uncontainable, you place the stars in the sky and you know amazing God. You are amazing God.
What an amazing God he is. Amen. His love. You may be seated.
Well, good morning. You know, St. Patrick's Day confuses me, and it falls in the middle of the week. I don't know if I'm supposed to wear green before, on the Sunday before, or the Sunday after. And then I don't know if I'm supposed to wear green or orange. You can look that one up later. But now, obviously, I'm looking around and seeing that I should have worn the cool T-shirt, because there are a lot of them. And I'm thrilled about this. The more I hear about this ministry, the more excited I am for it. And so I am thankful to see so many shirts, and thankful for what that means for the kingdom. So let us, as we get ready to begin this part of the service, let us have a word of prayer. Our Father in heaven, God, we praise you, we worship you today. You are an amazing God. And God, as we move into this part of our worship time, as we have sang songs to worship you, to lift you up, and now as we move into this part where we look to your word and lift you up in our hearts as we hear what you have to say to us, God, we pray that that we would have ears to hear what your word has to say, that we would have hearts that are ready to bend to your word. And God, I pray that you would be with me, that you would forgive me and cleanse me of my sin, that you would be able to use me this morning as a preacher of your word, God, that God, just take the words that I've put down here and somehow turn it into a sermon, and somehow, God, use that sermon to work in our hearts. So be with us as we look to your word this morning. And we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, the pastor was called out of town for a family emergency late one Friday, and he asked the associate pastor to cover the sermon on Sunday. And upon getting back to town, he saw a church member at the gas station, and while they were both filling up their tanks, the pastor asked him, "Well, how did the associate pastor's sermon go on Sunday?" "Oh, it was a poor, poor sermon," the church member responded to him. "Hardly anything to it at all." Later, the pastor got back to the church office and was touching base with the associate pastor when he asked him, "How did it go on Sunday morning?" "Oh, excellently," the associate pastor replied, smiling. "I didn't have time to prepare anything myself, so I just used one of yours." We've been studying the book of Jude, and we're almost done. You remember that Jude started off his little letter warning his readers that some false teachers had infiltrated their church and urging them to contend for the faith. He then spent the bulk of his letter describing these false teachers and making it very clear that they are ungodly men and spelling out the doom that awaits them. And last week, Jude finally got around to telling us what we're supposed to do. But his answer may be somewhat surprising. I actually split his answer into two parts, but neither part tells us how to get rid of the false teachers. And he's not being negligent or unconcerned. In both parts, he addresses his audience with the affectionate term, beloved. Last week, Jude tried to encourage his audience, particularly reminding them that the presence of these false teachers was an indication that we're in the last times. This week, Jude gives the church three important things to focus on. Look with me, if you will, at the book of Jude, and we're going to look at verses 19 through 23. Jude, verses 19 through 23, it is these false teachers who cause divisions, worldly people, devoid of the Spirit. But you, beloved, building yourselves up in your most holy faith and praying in the Holy Spirit, keep yourselves in the love of God, waiting for the mercy of our Lord Jesus Christ that leads to eternal life. And have mercy on those who doubt. Save others by snatching them out of the fire. To others, show mercy with fear, hating even the garment stained by the flesh. So Jude, in these few verses here, gives us three things to focus on. And the first one, I'm going to use a word that I don't believe I've ever used in a sermon outline before, and that is, Jude tells us, basically, don't be bamboozled. What do I mean by that? Well, he's telling his audience that these men, these false teachers, are the ones that are causing divisions, not you. You see, first, by claiming to be something special, they are creating a separation between them and the rest of the church. They're claiming to be kind of a higher level of spiritual than most, a sort of upper class, the spiritual upper class. So that's how these false teachers were making themselves out to be. And this elite attitude has showed up in things like the Lord's Supper. If you remember when we talked about that, where they were trying to be first and they were expecting the best. But second, they were likely defending themselves by saying that those who were coming against them were creating division. So these false teachers that Jude is telling us, they're the ones creating the division. They are throwing the accusation against those that are coming against them. The ones that are saying, no, you're not doing this right. They're going, oh, now, you're just causing division. You're just trying to split the church. Let's just all work together. See, some may have already been contending for the faith, pointing out where these false teachers were straying from orthodoxy, which is just a big theological word for right teaching, and from orthopraxy, which again is a big theological term for right practice, for doing the right things. So these false teachers were straying both from orthodoxy, they were teaching false things, and from orthopraxy, they were definitely doing wrong things. Jude describes them as being involved in sensual activities, and so there's some sexual sins against them and things like that. So they're definitely erring in both of these ways, and it seems like some people were starting to come against them and contend for the faith against these false teachers, and these false teachers may have been trying to deflect these charges, saying that those pointing them out are causing division, and we need to focus on unity. We need to all be together. We're all the church. We need to be unified, right? So here, Jude is reminding the church that pointing out these kinds of issues does not make you the one causing division. They, the false teachers, have already caused the division. I don't know if anyone follows the workings of the Southern Baptist Convention, but we are in a struggle right now, with some saying that the SBC is ignoring important doctrinal issues, and others saying we should ignore those doctrinal issues and focus on unity. So we see this kind of at play even in the Southern Baptist Convention. Jude goes on to say that these people are worldly. Here Jude is saying he agrees with them. These false teachers, they are on a separate spiritual level, just not the one that they pretend to be on. By calling them worldly, Jude is pointing out which instincts they follow. They are not driven by godly instincts, but by natural or sensual ones. Jude pointed this out way back in verse 4. It says, "For certain people have crept in unnoticed, who long ago were designated for this condemnation, ungodly people who pervert the grace of our God into sensuality and deny our only Master and Lord Jesus Christ." They are worldly in their instincts and in the way that they think. And then he says they do not have the Spirit. Jude is reiterating his judgment that these false teachers are ungodly, that they are not Christians. If you have the Spirit, there are evidences of that. John chapter 16 and verse 8 tells us Jesus speaking here, "And when he," meaning the Holy Spirit, "comes, he will convict the world concerning sin and righteousness and judgment." People with the Holy Spirit feel the conviction of sin. The Holy Spirit convicts of sin. These men, these false teachers, do not show any idea of conviction for their sin. Passage that's probably familiar to many, Galatians chapter 5, verses 22 and 23. "But the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control. Against such things there is no law. The Holy Spirit bears fruit. In fact, we could look at that whole section of Galatians chapter 5 from verses 16 through 26. These men are displaying the opposite of the fruit described here. They're not gentle. They're not kind. They're not loving. They're not patient. These men are the opposite of what of the fruit of the Holy Spirit. So Jude is saying here, don't let these false teachers make you feel guilty as if you were creating division. These divisions already exist because of who they are and what they do, not because of you. So don't be bamboozled. That's the first thing to focus on from Jude this morning. The second is in verses 20 and 21. Build yourself up in God. The main action, the main verb of these two verses is actually keep yourselves in the love of God. Now, when you read that, please understand the idea isn't that we can make God stop loving us. The idea is that a loving relationship requires action. What happens if we start to ignore our spouse? Eventually, they will wonder if you still love them. We need to ask, is our Christian life active? John 14, 15, Jesus says, if you love me, keep my commandments. See, love is a very active thing. It's not a passive, I love this person, I love Jesus, I love whatever. It's not just a statement, it's not just a check, it's an action. And we are to keep ourselves in the love of God. And then we do that with all the other verbs in these two verses tell us how to keep ourselves in the love of God. First of all, by building yourselves up in your most holy faith. Although keep is the main verb, a lot of the focus of these two verses has to do with building ourselves up. I think Jude is emphasizing this idea because the attitude of the false teachers and the whole conflict with them has gotten them probably feeling beaten down. And so he's saying, I want to encourage you to build yourselves back up. Build yourselves up. But do it the right way. He doesn't just want to make them feel better. He wants them to know better. To be better prepared for the issue again. Or to help others fighting against false teachers. Build yourself up in your most holy faith, or it could be on, either one, in your faith, on your faith. Either way, the faith is the foundation to be built on. Most holy, that's kind of an interesting way of describing the faith. I think the idea there is holy means separate. And so Judas saying, by most holy, he's saying this is altogether different from the world. Altogether different. We talked back when we looked at, before I get there, I suspect Judas is still playing with the causing divisions thing. When he says uses this most holy, encouraging his audience to really show how different they are, how separated they are, he's saying, yeah, there should be a division, and it really should be very distinct. You should be utterly different from the world. Most holy, your most holy faith is the one in verse 3 that was once for all delivered to the saints. we talked about the fact that this faith is the set of doctrines that we believe. Things like who Jesus is and how we are saved, things like that. And he says, he instructs us, build yourselves up, grow spiritually. Our Christian life should be a process of sanctification where we are becoming more like Christ, more like what we will be in heaven. I think I've described to you before, salvation is a three-part kind of thing, three different words that we could use to describe salvation, a past, a present, and a future tense to our salvation. In the past, we were, when we came to salvation, when we were saved, that time when we prayed to God that God, please save me, I believe that Jesus paid the price for my sins on the cross. I repent of those sins and I come to you, God, please save me. That moment in time, that is called justification. That's salvation past. Right now, from that point until we get to heaven, we're going through a process of what the Bible describes as being saved. You are being saved. And it's not like we're almost saved and then we're a little more saved. It's not that. We're going through a process called sanctification. It's salvation present. It's the act of becoming more like Jesus, becoming more like what we're going to be in heaven. And then when we do get to heaven, we will finally be saved in the future tense, and that's called glorification. And so our salvation is an ongoing process throughout our life, from the beginning of when we prayed to God and found Jesus, until that time that we're in heaven. It's an ongoing process, a past, present, and future to our salvation. And so our Christian life now should be a process of sanctification. We are to build ourselves up. We are to grow spiritually. We do this, at least in large part, by studying the Scriptures. 2 Timothy reminds us of this. Second Timothy chapter 3. And some days the pages just don't turn. Sorry about that. 2 Timothy and chapter 3, verses 16 and 17. All Scripture is breathed out by God and profitable for teaching, for reproof, for correction, and for training in righteousness, that the man of God may be complete, equipped for every good work. That's how we grow. That's a big part of how we grow spiritually, is by focusing on the Word. The next verb in these two verses here is praying. Praying in the Holy Spirit. What's that talking about? Well, one thing to keep in mind for this is found in Romans 8:26. Romans 8:26 says, likewise the Spirit helps us in our weakness, for we do not know what to pray for as we ought, but the Spirit himself intercedes for us with groanings too deep for words. So when we don't know the words, the Holy Spirit helps us. That's what praying in the Holy Spirit involves. Now, some, I will tell you, some consider this to be talking about praying in tongues. But the most that we could really say is that this might include praying in tongues. It's certainly not all or even the main thing that it's trying to communicate. It is trying to communicate like what I said there in Romans 8:26. To let the Holy Spirit be a part of our prayer, communicating the things that we can't form into words. God, God, just do it. Just do the God thing. And the Holy Spirit says, oh, okay, here's the deal. And takes it from there. One thing I will notice when visiting a new church is how often they pray during the service. How important is prayer in your Christian life? Praying is something that these false teachers likely avoided since their prayers were never really heard. These ungodly men, if they prayed at all, it had to have been incredibly uncomfortable for them. And so they probably avoided it altogether. And Jude, as he's contrasting, he's really, in these verses, he's contrasting the false teachers with what we're supposed to be like. And so as he's contrasting that, he's saying, you, my beloved, pray in the Holy Spirit. And then, waiting for the mercy of our Lord Jesus Christ. Again, Jude is pointing to the end times. We should be longing for this time, just as the first century Jews were longing for the Messiah. As we read the birth narrative in the Gospels, as we read about what was going on there, we see people that are just aching for the Messiah to come. God, let me live long enough to see your Messiah. God, let me live to see that. They were yearning for the Messiah. Likewise, we should be yearning for the day when Jesus comes back. The end times may have been something that the false teachers avoided. Again, because with that comes judgment. And so they may have felt the weight of that. And so they avoided it. So build yourselves up personally. Build yourselves up. Grow spiritually. And then the third thing to focus on is be benevolent to others. Now, I will tell you that there are some textual differences here in this section, and I'm not going to cover all of those with you. I could honestly probably split this section up into two sermons, but I think it's better to put it into one, and we're just going to focus on what is, I think, the best translation of these verses. Be benevolent to others. First of all, have mercy on those who doubt. See, these aren't the false teachers. These ones who doubt, these are brothers and sisters that are affected by the false teachers. Don't treat them the same as the false teachers. There is to be a gentleness here. When people have started, well, that kind of makes sense. Then gently lead them back and say, okay, I hear what you're saying. I understand where that's coming from. Let's go back and see what the Word of God has to say about that. And be gentle with them. Show mercy to them. When somebody walks into your Sunday school classroom and saying, oh, you should hear what this TV preacher had to say, and you go, oh, not that one, not that one. No. Okay, tell me what you heard. Okay, well, let's take a look at what scripture they used for that. Oh, they didn't use a scripture. Okay, well, let's see how scripture relates to what they were trying to say. And gently lead them back to the Word. There's a second group. Jude says, save others by snatching them out of the fire. This second group is farther down the wrong path, and they're in danger. These folks require more direct, little less gentle attention. But we need to react to them. We need to reach out to them. And then there's a third group. To others, show mercy with fear. This third group may be unsaved people. And the fear seems to be a fear of contamination, basically, of being impacted by their sin and the non-Christian beliefs that they have. Consider, for instance, witnessing to a Jehovah's Witness. There should be a certain amount of concern about your attempting to show them our merciful Savior may result in them showing you their teaching in a way that confuses you for a time. That's the kind of idea that he's communicating there. There's a concern, a fear, if you will, of, well, wait a minute, they said this, and that kind of made sense. That's what he's warning about, is that you should be afraid, you should be concerned that that some of the teaching that they have, which you should know is false going into it, but still, oh, it kind of makes sense. And then so then you regroup, you go back to the Word and find out, oh, okay, that's why that's not right. But there should be a certain fear, a certain concern that's there. But don't let any of these situations scare you from these people who need to know the true Jesus. The command is still go, still share, still save. So be benevolent, be loving. As I said, there's more that we could have looked at with this text. I probably could have split it into two sermons, but keeping it all together hopefully helps to show Jude's heart and an encouragement for his readers and for us. We have work to do. Being a Christian isn't a checkbox on a form. And from your shirts, I see you get it. I want to encourage you to, with something you already know, don't come to church because you're a Christian. Come to church because you want to be more Christ-like. Does that make sense? You understand what I'm saying? It's not I come to church because I'm a Christian. It's what I'm supposed to do. No, come to church because you want to be more Christ-like. Christ said to gather together. Christ said to learn from each other, learn from the Word. We come to church to learn from the Word, to love on our brothers and sisters. Come to church to be more Christ-like. We're going to have a time of invitation. It's a time when we sing, but also we think about the Word that we've looked at, the message this morning, and see, how does this apply to me? And what am I supposed to do? How am I supposed to react to this? And it's a time, hopefully, when the Holy Spirit is working with your heart and maybe showing you some of the rough spots that need to be worked out. So I encourage you to, if you feel like the Holy Spirit is trying to deal with you with something, don't worry about the singing. Other people will do the singing. You just work, you just talk with God. You do the talking with God. That's far more important. So I encourage you to do that. If God is leading you to ask questions, if you need to ask me questions, come up and ask me, or if you don't want to come forward during the invitation, I understand. I'm going to try to get out to the foyer after the service is over. Grab me out there and ask me questions out there. That'll be fine. But don't leave this building today with questions that are unanswered, with things that God is telling you to do and you haven't done them. Let us pray.
Chasing I think my main takeaway was that the fellowship with other believers while you're serving is just really sweet and a joyful thing, no matter what you're doing.
Well, it was really awesome hearing the people being so grateful for the things that we were able to do, even though we couldn't do everything that we wanted to do because the snow and all that stuff were raking leaves. So it was just really amazing, people just being so grateful, and they really needed the help. So I can't wait to do it again tomorrow.